and I've been trying to get back, but it just hasn't worked out. I thank y'all for letting me come. I thank y'all for the monthly support. It's great. It keeps me going, but the main thing that keeps me going down the road is prayer. Now, everything that's been going on, I'm getting older. And things are taking changes in my life. Now, first off, those that might remember my wife, Sister Barbara, all right, she used to sing and travel with me and do ventriloquism. She has not been able to travel with me anymore. Our oldest daughter, Diane, she's 40 this year, and she has MS. So we found out that. And then from that point, our grandson, one of her sons, Daniel, he has autism. So it's come down to the point that with Diane not being from one day to the next, knowing whether she's even going to be able to get up out of bed or not, Barbara has had to start staying home and take care of her. But I have continued on the road, traveling, giving out God's word in the way I do. I'm going to try to make a long story short, but what happened back in 2016 when the flood happened down home in South Louisiana, we had trailer damage that we had in the one we were living at out in the country, and we had roof damage come in, and we had black smoke set in, and we couldn't live in that trailer anymore. It was gone. So from that point, it just so happened that the apartment right next to my daughter, Diane, opened up. The Lord provided that for us. We got there, and then it was after that we found out about the MS. She had been having problems, but the Lord put us right where we needed to be in spite of the problems that we were having. Well, since then, and I'm not going to go all into this, but our youngest daughter, she had been staying with us with her husband and with our granddaughter, and we've been sharing expenses and things like that, even at the trailer and everything. She moved from Kentucky to Louisiana, where I've been pastoring before. And anyway, well, now they're talking about my son-in-law has gotten to a position at work that will make it possible that they can buy a house. All right, so we're sharing expenses, and we can't cover the expenses of the apartment that we're staying in. So they said, well, by springtime or by summer, we're going to be getting us a house. So we said, we got to do something. And we found out this at the end of last year. So therefore, we said, okay, we're so used to living for, well, 5 years, we traveled in an RV, we lived in an RV. And then most of the time, over the past 16 years, we've been living in hotels and things like that. So therefore, we decided we're going to get us a travel trailer. And through the churches, the different churches' help, we have been able to get us a 33-foot travel trailer that has slide-outs. And now they're at the KOA campground, two exits down from my daughter. So Barbara can still drive over there and take care of her and all that kind of stuff. But now we have that, and it's a lot cheaper than what we've been paying. So the Lord has provided in that way there. Now, I said, I just finished up 16 years full-time on the road, giving out God's word in the way that we've done it. During that 16 years, God has allowed us to minister in every state except for Hawaii. I hadn't made it there yet. They've been wanting us to come, but we hadn't made it to there. In 7 different countries. And I never know when I'm going to different countries. Hey, just back in October, I was down in South Arizona, speaking at a church down there, and the pastor there, he knew I was going to be there for a few days, and he said, hey, you want to go to Mexico? And I said, sure. Well, what we did was, it just so happens that week, which I didn't realize that, and it didn't register in my head, fine, about 3.5 hours southwest of Nogales, Arizona, down into Mexico, in Coporca, there's a prison. And I've been there several times already, and we said, let's go again. So we went down to that prison and did a chapel service for the people there, as far as I go. Now, has anyone here ever been to a Mexican prison? It's very interesting. It's very primitive in a way. But one time when I was there at that prison, we had our sound system hooked up and stuff, and there were some wires that needed to be stripped and all. And one of the fellows just said, breaks, get under the table. Because they're just going to start shooting. And that's it. And while we were there, we only had a few people in there in that chow hall. And when I first went there, I wasn't sure what to expect. All right? The fellow that was actually, I had several preachers with it, the fellow that was actually running the thing, he didn't tell me how long I had. So all I did was I took a bag and I put a whole bunch of tricks and things like that in there that I knew that I could work out and flow just on the, for a moment. So after they had done singing and everything, and of course all of this has been done in Spanish and all, which I don't speak Spanish, so I had to use a translator. But after they did all that, then they had me stand on top of the cement table. And I had my bag sitting there, my tricks, and the fellow that was running the thing, he was in a wheelchair right down here. And from that point, I said, okay, I still don't know how long I have. So I grabbed the trick out of there, and I started giving the gospel with the trick, and the person translating for me and all that, you know, so that worked out great. And the fellow down there said, do another. So I grabbed another one, and I just continued giving some Christian principles and all right, and they said, do another. Now, as this was going on, more people started coming in. They filled the whole chow hall, and then from that point, people were looking through the windows from outside, watching. Word got around, and there was somebody in there doing magic tricks, and they came to see this fellow doing magic tricks. So I went, at that time, I went for an hour, just kept going, doing another. And finally, I was out. That was it. That's all the tricks I had left. From that point, a couple of inmates, they fell in the wheelchair at all, picked it all up, put it on top of the table. And then from that point, he said some things to them. He gave an invitation. And I don't know how many we have to respond, but I know that day we ended up with 23 saved.
Amen.
And just this past October, we had 17 saved.
Amen.
So they still want me to come back sometime and do the whole prison instead of just small groups that we've been doing. But the past 16 years, God has allowed me to see, on the average, over 200 souls saved every year.
Amen.
And that's dealing with a one-on-one. So keep me in prayer as I still keep going. Now, I made a comment a while ago about getting older. Last year did not go the way I planned. Now, you have to understand this, and I'm sure you know this. We have our plans, and God has His plans. And years ago, I went through two heart attacks. And my doc told me, you need to come apart and rest a while, or you just play and come apart. And I learned that. Well, this past year, I've had these prostate problems. My PSA numbers have been high and everything, and they found three spots. But thank the Lord, they weren't cancerous. They're benign. But it's in Lord's. And they got me on medicine dealing with that and all the side effects there. And then on top of all that, when they done a couple of biopsies, they done the MRIs. When they did the MRIs, they also found out I had two hernias. Now, the doctor ain't done nothing yet about that. But he just says, take it easy. I try to. But anyway, with those ailments and things like that, and then, you know, there's two professions I don't care for. Doctors and mechanics. They always tell you something you don't want to hear, and it costs you more than you care to pay. Well, anyway, he mentioned the word to me called pre-diabetic. So now they got me on this metformin stuff and things like that. So my Passover didn't go the way I wanted it. I had to keep returning home for doctor's appointments, for biopsies, for all that kind of stuff. Keep me in prayer as I keep going, doing what God wants me to do, that I can physically keep it up. And that's what I plan on doing, no matter what. You know, I thank y'all for the support. I thank y'all for the prayer support. That's what keeps me going on God, doing God's work where He wants me to go. My summers are my busiest time. Right now, this is just a short trip that I made this way. I'll be in the mission conference in Winter Haven at Westwood this week here, and then I'm heading back home, and I got to get things ready as the summers come and everything and other events and all. But keep me in prayer as I try to get a little rest, because I want to keep going for God and do what He wants me Lord. Now, I do want to tell you this. I do not know if I have done this particular message here. And the reason I tell you I do not know, because over the years, upon moving from 2016 and just recently moving, I have put a bunch of stuff in storage. Now, what does that mean? I write my stuff on index cards. And on the back, I write where I was and when I did. Can't find a bunch of my index cards. Not to include the fact that twice my car has been broken into, once in Canada and another time in Las Vegas, and both times they busted the window and they took my briefcase. Now the only thing they got both times in my briefcase was a whole bunch of cards like this, some calendars, and the New Testament.
Amen.
That's all they got. But so therefore, I don't know, some of these things you may have seen in the past. If you've seen it in the past, don't tell anyone what happens. Next to you, maybe they don't remember or they didn't see it. On top of that, it gives you an opportunity to figure it out again. But I've also learned a long time ago, when it comes to preaching God's word, preaching a message that he gives you, I've learned that number one, if it's not worth preaching the second time, then it wasn't worth preaching the first time. On top of that, if God has set it up that y'all going to hear it a second time, well, maybe he figured you didn't pay attention the first time.
Yeah.
So he wants you to see it now. Anyway, I'm going to get started with it. I've got this hourglass and y'all recognize it. I can remember the very first time I ever saw an hourglass. It was well over 50 years ago. I remember this woman across the street from us. She used to babysit us. And in our house, she had these wooden floors and a spiral rug in her living room. And every day, at the same time, she would lay me down on that rug, and she'd put a blanket on me. And then I would roll over, and I would see a black and white TV, and this is what I would hear.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of our lives.
That was the very first time I remember seeing an hourglass. It was right there on that screen.
This is my commentary.
How many remember that? Raise your hand. How many still watch that? Raise your hand. But that was the very first time, as far back as I can remember, ever seen an hourglass was on that TV screen, a black and white TV, and there was an hourglass. A few years ago, a couple of years ago or so, I like old country music, old classics, all right? But they got the new stuff out there, and I'll be flipping around on the radio station, come across some of that new country music, and they had one of these, I don't even remember who the fella is, but he was singing a song, and in that song, he was talking about a TV interview that was taking place with a fellow that had turned 100 years old. And he was asking, the reporter was asking the typical questions that you would ask somebody who turns 100 years old. But one of the things that the fellow responded in this song concerning getting that old is, and I think this is the title of the song, it's called Don't Blink. And he talked about the fact of an hourglass, that life is like the sands of an hourglass. And before you know it, it's over with. It's finished. It's done. Don't blink. It can come just that quick. Well, you know, as I take a look at the hourglass, and I got to thinking about that and what I heard him say on there, I can't help but think, we all, when I look at that hourglass, I think about myself. I think about others around me, all right? And I think that we all have our hourglass that was started at different times. But we don't know when our hour glass is going to be finished. We don't know when the saints is going to be done. Right? In fact, listen to this. It says, the sands of life are started but once, and no man has the power to tell just when the sand will stop, at late or early hour. To lose one's wealth is sad indeed. To lose one's health is more. To lose one's soul is such a loss that no man can restore. The present only is our own. Live, love, toil with a will. Place no faith in tomorrow, for the sand may then be still. You think about I'm going to set this right over here. And every so often, kind of take a glance at that hourglass. I think about those different ones. But when it comes to time, when it comes to the sands of life, what are we supposed to do? What does the Bible tell us? Well, I look over in Ephesians in chapter 5 and verse 16. It says, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Now, we can't deny that. The way things are going today, we look at the days are evil. So we need to wisely be redeeming the time, using God's time that he has given us the way he wants it. But what are we supposed to be doing? Well, you got to look at surrounding verses. Verse 14, wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepeth, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee life. We need to wake up and see what God wants us to do. We need to wake up and see what's going on in this world and respond and act to it. He even says right here, the next verse, see then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. You've heard that old saying that our walk must match our talk. You know, we need to be living as Christians. We need to be living wisely, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. He has given us time on this earth. He has something for us to do, each and every one of us. He puts us in places to do his will. And that's what we need to be doing. But sometimes it's a struggle in life. I need two volunteers to help me. Let's see here. How about that? I can come right on up here. How about that? So, right there. Yeah, come right on up here. Here's what I'm going to do. You, sir, take a stand right here. And you, sir, I need you to take a stand right over here. Great. Now here's what we're going to do. I've got two pieces of rope. You take those over to that rope, take it out, make sure there's no holes, trap doors, magnets, anything like that. They're just plain old piece of rope. You take a look at this rope, make sure there's no holes, trap doors. They are just simple pieces of rope. That's all. Did you find a hole in this rope? Oh, you missed it. It's right here. All right. Hold yours just like this here. All right. Did you find a hole? All right, now here's what we're going to do. Let go of the rope. We're going to put it right here just like this. Hold on to that line right there, just like that. Come right over here. Let's bring yours. Put that right there. And you hold on to the line right there. And then what we're going to do is we're going to take and tie this up just like this. All right. Now let go of the line, please. Hold the end of the rope. Hold that right there. Hold that right there. Hold it good and tight up here, but don't let go of more. Just hold it up here so everybody can see it. All right, there, that's great, right there. Now, this here, these ropes have beginnings and ends, just like a life. A life has a beginning and an end. But this represents a Christian life, okay? You see, it's a red rope. See, if you know Jesus as your Savior, you're covered by the blood of Jesus. So there's a Christian life, but just because it's a Christian life does not mean that we don't sin. We're going to have sin in our life. In fact, we have the darkness of sin all the way around. Now here, this is going to represent sin in our lives. I want anybody just to yell out of sin. It don't have to be your own. It can be anybody else's sin. Just yell out of sin. Huh? Yell it out.
Stealing.
Okay, we're going to put it right here, just like this here. All right. Now, yell out another sin.
Lying.
Lying. Okay, we're going to put it right over here, just like this. All right. Yell out another sin. Killing. I knew that one was coming up. All right. We're going to put that right there. And one more sin.
Adultery.
Adultery. All right. We'll put it right there. Now, see, we have many different sins. Some you may have committed. Some maybe you have not committed. But we have sin. No matter what, we're going to have sin in our lives until the day we leave this earth. It's going to be there. And in fact, come down just a little bit. In fact, sometimes we get tangled up in our sins. Give me one of your ropes, please. Just one of them. All right, and give me one of yours. All right. So therefore, we do get tangled up in our sins. All right. Take hold of that one. Take hold of that. All right. But remember, this is a Christian life that we're talking about. And in a Christian life, this purple represents royalty. We have a king in our life. And that's Jesus. He's right here with us. All right? And this here, remember, is our Christian life. This here is green like the grass. And we need to be growing like the grass grows. We need to grow in the love of Jesus. That's through Bible study, through prayer, through going to church, those things there. We need to be growing in our life. But what we want to do is grow closer to Jesus. Get closer to Him. But, hold on a second. There's something keeping me from getting close to Jesus. What is it?
Sin.
That's right. How do we spell that word sin? S-I-N. And what's the middle letter there? I. When I look at what I want in life and don't consider what God wants into my life, then sin comes into my life. Alright? And we need to be willing to get rid of that sin that's in our life. We need to pray and ask for forgiveness. But first we need to get rid of that I. See, that looks like an I right there. We need to get rid of that I in that sin. We need to get rid of that I in our life. When we quit looking at what I want, then we pray and ask for forgiveness of sin. What's the last word in that prayer? Amen. So let's hear that. 1, 2, 3.
Amen.
And when we do that, we're no longer tangled up in that sin. Now we can be close to Jesus and grow closer to Him each and every day. And that's what we want to do in that Christian life. That's how we need to be redeeming that time, is getting closer to Jesus. Thank y'all very much. Give them a hand for helping me. That talks about our walk. That talks about our talk. That talks about what we need to be doing. Listen, we can't be reaching people for Jesus as we ought to if they don't see Jesus in us. It doesn't work. One of my most favorite singers was a fellow by the name of Jake Hicks. How many know who Jake Hess was? Yeah, if you watch the Gator video, they always picked on him about his wig, you know. But anyway, one of the things that he was asked, I got to camp to meet him several times. I just love listening to a fellow sing. But one of the things he said one time, he was asked a question concerning his life and his closeness to Jesus. How did you do that? And he said, what I do is I envision the cross of Jesus. And I get as close as I can to it, that I can see the splinters and the flesh things on that cross. And that helps me to remember and think about the fact that Jesus died for me, and I need to be living for Him. So I try to get as close as I can to it. And that's what we ought to do. But sometimes we get busy in life, and we don't do as we ought to. I need some volunteer to help me. Let's see here. Wait, hold on. No, I need somebody over. Where was our BTC teacher? Where did he go? Yeah, where's he at?
No, that's you.
Come right on up here. Thank you, I enjoyed that class in BTC. Now, you know, people quite often ask me about when I first started learning how to do these tricks and stuff. Well, this year makes 50 years that I've been doing tricks. Now, I went to the library and I got books and I started reading and learning how to do tricks. But I also started learning things from my dad. Now, my dad didn't do tricks. But see, my dad was what was known called a bookie. How many know what a bookie is? Raise your hand. How many's used a bookie? Raise your hand. But for those that don't know, a bookie is one that takes bets on horse races and car races and ball games and things like that. And he had a bookie operation that he would run. And it was behind a legitimate business. And one of his businesses that he had set up was a commercial plumbing company. And in these big stores, they put the plumbing and stuff like that. It was a legitimate business. But the name of that business, pay attention, the name of his business was Acme Plumbing Company. Think about it. You ever watch The Roadrunner?
Yeah.
Everything the Coyote got came from the Acme Company. All right? But that was his name. Now, in the back of the business, he also had a table set up where people sat around, fellas sat around and played cards. Now, I was what they call a runner then. I was just a kid. But when my dad had to collect money or pay money out, I'd get on my bike and I'd ride to wherever it was within the town there and get the money and drop the money off. See, the police didn't suspect this kid running around on the bike doing things that were illegal. But I got to hang around these fellows playing the cards. And they taught me card tricks and coin tricks and things like that. Well, now, back before all this, my dad worked for the space program. Y'all might remember the Saturn V and Saturn VI rockets that went up back in the 60s. Well, he wrote manuals on those rockets. And I read newspaper articles on him after the fact. They called him a walking computer. He had a good mind when it comes to math. All right? And there's a thing when you're playing cards called counting cards. And that's where you can know the positions of the card in the deck. All right? Now, we're going to do something like that, and I've got cards big enough that we can see. All right? But here's what we're going to do. The way we're going to do it, but instead of counting the cards, we're going to spell the cards. You okay with spelling?
I can count better than I can spell.
Well, I'll help you with the spelling. And the way we're going to do this is for each letter of the cards we go through, we're going to move a card from the top to the bottom. It's like we want to find the A's. All right, so A, C, E, and we get the H. You see that? That's how that works. Now we're going to do it with two. All right, I'm going to let you take it. All right, and for each letter, we're going to move the part from top to the bottom. T, W, O, and the next one is the two. No. That's the king of hearts. That reminds me of Jesus. Jesus needs to be the king of our heart. All right, see, the way this works is it's T, W, O, and you get the two. You see that? All right, let's tie it with the three, okay? There you go. T, H, R, E, E, and the next one is a three. No, that's the king of hearts. I said that reminds us of Jesus. Right. You see, it came back. Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
We've got to look for Jesus to come back again. See, show back up again. See, it's T, H, R, E, E, and you get the three. It seems like you are having a problem with the spelling. Well, we're going to count now, okay? Count to four. That's it. I take that. One, two, three, four, and the next one is, no, that's the king again. It's not the four. To say Jesus is coming back in. We need to remember that. We get busy in life and doing other things, you know, and we tend to forget about the fact that Jesus is coming back.
Right.
You know, we get busy in our daily life. We get to tell others about Jesus as we ought to, because we're not thinking that Jesus will come back at any moment, at any time. You see, the way that works is one, two, three, four, and you got the four. Let me show you how that works with the five. All right, the five is F, I, V, E, and you got the five. You see that? Hold on, that's the king. Well, you know what? It don't matter whether you're a preacher or not. Sometimes we even get busy about things and we get about the fact that Jesus is coming back again. Take hold of this. Do the five. F, I, V, E. And the next one is the five. Look at that. He got it. That's great. That's wonderful. But what's left in his hand? The king of hearts. If you don't take anything else away from this trip, take this. Number one, Jesus needs to be the king of our heart. Number two, the king is coming back again.
Amen.
And we need to act like we expect him. Hey, I believe in the imminent return of Jesus.
That's right.
And if we truly believe in the imminent return, it would definitely change the way we live our life.
Amen.
Thank you very much. Give him a hand for helping me. You know, Jesus is coming back again. We don't know when, but he is coming back. But I can't help but to think about what Jesus has done for us. I need another volunteer to help me. You know what? I need a fellow. I need a girl, a woman. To help me. Let's see here. I need somebody tall enough. All right. Who we got here? Come on, give me a volunteer. What about, is there a teenager back there that wants to help me?
Sarah.
right here. And I want y'all to see these. This one here is what color?
Green.
Green. And this one is?
White.
And this one?
Black.
And this one?
Gray.
Now, these are all the same except they're different colors. And this one here happens to have a nail in it. Have that nail and tell me if it's sharp. Is it sharp? Now, they may not believe us. So, therefore, I've got a balloon right here. Let's see here. Yep, it's sharp. So here's what we're going to do. Come right on over here, please. And I want you to take and put these cups on here in any order that you want. Is that the order you want to leave the cups in? All right, now what I want you to do is move the disc around and put them in any order that you want them in, as long as you end up with them in a straight line. Is that the way you want to leave them? All right, how many believe I can tell which one has the nail under it? Of course, I watched her. But we're going to make this a little more interesting. I have a blindfold right here. I take the blindfold and put I've got a better idea. Let's put the blindfold on you. Put your hands on top of your eyes, please. Turn around. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take this and we're going to tie it up just like this. Want to make sure it's good and tight so it don't slip. Alrighty, here we go. Now turn around right here. Alright, now how many fingers I got up?
Seven.
Wrong. I hope you get the next part right. You mix these up, you know the order that they're in. I'm going to take put your hand above these, and you're going to have to worry about it, and I'm going to smash your. I better not do that. No, I don't think I have insurance for that. So what we're going to do is I'm going to let you put this on me. Alright? You like that idea better. Tie them real tight. Squeeze my brain out. My wife says I need to be brainless to do this. Alright. Now, what I need you to do is I've got some duct tape right down here. It's attached down here. Take that duct tape. My wife tends to think that I could easily put a hole here. Alright, so I want you to take that duct tape, cover up my nose, and right there, cover up those holes right there with that duct tape. Alright? Oh, I can hear you. My wife's going along with the hair, and you just clap your arm at her. Alright, now what I need you to do is I want you to rearrange the disc again and tell me when you're done. Thank you very much. Give her a hand for helping me. Now, I'm going to tell you something. This is just a trick. I knew where the nail was the whole time. But I was not willing to take that nail in my hand. But Jesus knew that there was a nail coming for him. And he willingly stretched out his arms and took that nail for you and I. I want to tell you about that day and what Jesus did for us. Many years ago, Jesus left a wonderful place called heaven.